The following program contains coarse language and violence. Viewer discretion is advised.
You don't have consent to enter our territory! You are invaders!
Under arrest, get down!
On this edition of the Fifth Estate, in BC, the battle lines have been drawn.
Don't pick her up like that! Hey! That's not gentle!
And when the fight over this land gets heated, the RCMP has a special unit to call in.
And they've tried to break my legs. They've tried to break every single piece on me.
The RCMP call it the Community Industry Response Group. Its main job, police the protests against multi-billion dollar resource projects in BC. But many are asking, just who and what are they there to protect?
Private mercenaries for industry. That's what they are to me.
The CIRG is there to protect the private property interests of corporations, full stop.
A specialized unit that looks more like the military than police, costing millions.
Who's supposed to step in to keep the people safe?
Grab his legs.
The practice and the impunity behind it, it's shocking.
After more than 1,000 arrests, the unit is now facing lawsuits and hundreds of complaints. So we take those concerns to the RCMP.
My police officers have been assaulted, they've been attacked, our vehicles have been burnt. No arrest looks pretty.
At the root of it all here, just whose law rules this land?
We are not resolving 150 years of conflict staring down the barrel of a gun.
I'm Steven D'Souza. This is the Fifth Estate.
We're surrounded by tactical officers with guns. They cut off the internet.
They're outside the window.
Oh, they're outside the window.
It's November 2021 in a remote part of British Columbia.
Do you have a search warrant or an arrest warrant?
A weeks-long occupation by Indigenous leaders is about to reach a critical point with the RCMP.
They're walking to the door. They're breaking it down.
They were snipers in behind heavy machinery, trained on us. There were ERT with the semi-automatic weapons behind every single structure.
Get your fucking gun off me! Lower your gun! Get your fucking gun off me! This is sovereign but so it is mine! Get your gun off!
At one point that I turned around and I had to sit down and I just felt like throwing up. I felt nauseous because it was just overwhelming.
Here, Molly, you're under arrest.
Don't touch me.
Don't touch her.
Get your hands off of her.
You're under arrest.
Get your hands off of her. You're under arrest. It's territory.
For Molly Wickham, that raid in 2021 and this standoff in 2019.
All right, next is Molly. You know who Molly is?
Are two chapters in an ongoing struggle, captured over the years by filmmakers and journalists, where Indigenous resistance has come face to face with a new RCMP unit, the Community Industry Response Group.
The CIRG is a special unit of the RCMP that was created to police resource conflicts in British Columbia.
What CIRG does is it bridges the gap between general duty frontline police officers and tactical operations officers. They get specific training in how to deal with protests. Also, they have to be prepared to move at a moment's notice anywhere in the province.
Wet'suwet'en is an Indigenous territory that sits nestled in northwestern BC. Cutting through the heart of their land, the controversial Coastal GasLink pipeline. This is unceded territory.
We have never sold, surrendered, lost in war, or treated, signed any treaties to give up title to 22,000 square kilometers of territory.
Under Wet'suwet'en law, this is their land. The Supreme Court opened the door for that title to be recognized under Canadian law, but that hasn't happened yet.
Back up.
A central issue in a battle here over resource development and policing. Here, hereditary chiefs decide what happens on ancestral lands.
The BC government, from the very beginning, knew that the title holders in the territory are the hereditary leaders. When the Coastal GasLink project came, the hereditary leaders were somehow forgotten as title holders when negotiations proceeded.
Wickham and other Wet'suwet'en leaders say they're asserting their rights to their land.
I actually get really offended when people call us protesters because we're not. This is not something that we're just doing or opposing. This is us as Indigenous people, as Wet'suwet'en people, fighting for our right to be who we are.
The Coastal GasLink, or CGL pipeline, is a $14.5 billion natural gas project. It's owned in part by TC Energy, Canadian pension funds, and an American hedge fund. When completed, it will carry natural gas to LNG Canada. That facility will ship it overseas. LNG Canada is the largest private investment in Canadian history, one the BC government hopes will pump billions into the economy. In 2018, the BC Supreme Court issued an interim injunction to stop protests from blocking the main road to Coastal GasLink's work sites.
An injunction is an emergency stopgap measure. Corporations have found that injunctions are an incredibly useful tool for them when they want to stop protests against projects, particularly resource projects.
Injunctions are meant to be temporary until a trial can resolve any issues. But in cases like Wet'suwet'en, a common strategy is to delay going to trial, allowing the injunction to stand until work is complete.
Corporations are successful 76% of the time when they seek injunctions against Indigenous people.
The courts issue an order to the publicly funded RCMP to enforce the injunction.
With the CIRG in particular, it's incredibly concerning that the police have so much discretion to enforce injunctions.
This is a clash between Indigenous law and colonial law. In these cases, we're saying colonial law doesn't have jurisdiction, but it's also unjust, and the police are being used to enforce this unjust law. But they have the ability to choose how they are enforcing the injunction. They don't have to come in with militarized police.
We asked the former head of CIRG about the raid in Wet'suwet'en in 2021.
We just want to show you a quick video of a specific incident. Axes, chainsaws, I mean, you see the officer at the door. Is that reasonable to enforce the injunction?
For hours, we had been trying to call them out. You're under arrest. Identify yourself. Come on out. They didn't identify themselves, nor did they come out. So we have to go in.
Good morning. Just wondering why you keep coming every morning.
And my name is Janet Williams. I belong to the Wet'suwet'en, and the land means an awful lot to me.
Elders like Janet Williams say CIRG enforcement doesn't always involve axes and chainsaws.
Oh!
More often, she says, it's daily harassment and intimidation.
Anybody come close to my guys, they will be getting arrested.
They opened up our gates there. I have to literally go out every day and every night, chase them off my land, off my inta.
It's private property. You guys have no rights to be here whatsoever.
Every time I showed them my documents, they would not listen.
It's not your property.
It is land. It's right here.
It's Crown land, miss.
Who the hell told you it's Crown land? Where the hell did you get that idea from? This is Cassia territory, my house.
How CIRG is enforcing the injunction has put it under a microscope.
What's happened is these highly contentious political issues and legal issues are being treated as security problems.
The unit is now facing hundreds of complaints, an external review, and a number of lawsuits and civil cases. For more than a decade, Frida Hewson has lived in this lodge, a place of healing and defiance, right in the path of yet another pipeline development.
CGL put the injunction on us and used military force to force their way through.
You don't have consent to enter our territory!
The hereditary Unist'ot'en chief came up against Kyrg in 2020.
I used to have respect for police, but people wearing RCMP disrespecting us and treating us like we're not human. Police came and they cut down the temporary gate that we had.
From liaison officers to canine units to helicopters, it's an operation with deep pockets.
We had chopper activities circling our camp. They had heavy equipment.
You're in breach of the court injunction. If you remain here, you will be arrested.
We didn't represent any kind of threat to them. We were drumming and singing and doing an ancient bell ceremony. Seven of us got arrested.
Kyrg was formed in 2017 in response to growing anti-pipeline protests in BC and concerns blockades like Standing Rock in the US would inspire similar action in Canada. Especially around the Trans Mountain Pipeline Project. But Kyrg rose to national prominence in 2020 in Fairy Creek, policing anti-logging protests. Here, Kyrg found itself in the midst of one of the largest acts of civil disobedience in Canadian history.
The video that I have seen has really been characterized by, I would say, a level of disrespect for people's civil rights. Do I feel that the Kyrg followed the letter of the law? No.
And the guy, like all of them, masked up, no identification.
Raven is Anishinaabe from Quebec and came to Fairy Creek in 2021. She says she was arrested four times. In each case, she alleges Kyrg officers used excessive force and violence.
I mean, they pretty much pulled my shirt up at this point. My pants were pretty much taken down. So, like, I was pretty much exposed. They were also holding me down by my breasts. They were holding me down by my, like, vagina over here.
Her story, she says, a small sample of what Kyrg has allegedly done here. The standoff in Fairy Creek is over this, the logging of old growth and ancient forests. We drove deep into the mountains to see what's already been cut. One study estimates less than 3% of BC's old growth forests remain, and it's at risk.
Industry always says these trees are worth thousands of dollars. These trees are thousands of years old. We're never going to see them come back in our lifetime.
Around these parts, Rose Henry is known as Grandma Osa, a traditional name marking her importance as a matriarch.
I've been well known for speaking out about human rights. Fairy Creek and Wet'suwet'en, and the connection between the two blockades is really strong. The old growth will no longer stand if there's no water. And so it's all connected.
And in both, she says, they're facing a common adversary.
The demon, the bigger beast, is industry. And industry is using CIRG and the RCMP to enforce the destruction.
But just how closely does CIRG work with industry? Coming up, what internal emails reveal.
Absolutely, they crossed the line by writing directly to the RCMP.
And we see firsthand how private security operates in Wet'suwet'en.
We have somebody following us now. It's a Foresight security truck. Started following us about 2 kilometers back, and we'll see how long they continue to stay with us.
Silver Bronco.
You heard that, right?
I heard something.
Poor sight is falling.
We've come to Wet'suwet'en territory to understand what policing here looks like and why so many are calling for the RCMP's specialized unit, CIRG, to be disbanded. One allegation, that CIRG works hand-in-hand with private security companies contracted to Coastal GasLink, or CGL. That's a company building the multi-billion dollar pipeline cutting through Wet'suwet'en territory.
So we have somebody following us now. It's a Foresight security truck. Started following us about 2 kilometers back, and we'll see how long they continue to stay with us.
Foresight is a private security company contracted to CGL.
It's a very narrow road. You're not allowed to pass, so if you are being followed, there's nothing subtle about it. You're going to see them. You're going to know they're there.
These are public roads, so we pull over in case he wants to pass us.
Go ahead and scoot past us. We're just going to keep it.
Yeah, I think he's following us.
They know we're journalists because earlier that morning when we first arrived, both CGL security and the RCMP checked in.
Hey, what's up?
After about you guys, is that recreational or?
No, we're waiting for someone who's behind us.
Okay.
Yeah, you're good?
No worries. Yeah.
We're good.
You guys got a radio you can call it?
Yeah, we have a radio.
Okay, that's good.
There's a guy with his phone trained on us right now.
Yeah, so he's filming.
Later, when we meet Wickham, she says private security monitors their movements constantly. And she says it's all shared with the RCMP.
If CIRG is on the territory, they always stop in and check in with private security.
This watcher, though, doesn't seem to like it when the camera is turned on him.
There's no oversight for private security companies and how they operate and gather intelligence, but they can share that information that they could have gathered in a number of ways with RCMP.
I feel like as an Indigenous woman in rural areas, like we're really far out in the middle of nowhere, you know? If something happened, do you think that I would feel safe to call the police?
Quite often we're called to the scene by industry, whether it's their security teams or their workers. You know, we are impartial on this. If you're breaching the injunction, we will deal with it. If you're breaking the law, whether it's industry or protesters.
Back on the road, we're trying to access the area where Wickham was arrested in 2021. Remember, that's where CIRG broke down a door with an axe and chainsaw.
Hi. Afternoon, gentlemen, how are you?
Good.
Good, good?
Good.
But we're stopped at a CGL checkpoint.
To ensure the safety and integrity of the worksite, Coastal GasLink is restricting access past Zero Martin.
We're told clearly what will happen if we try and breach the injunction.
If we were to go past, you would contact the RCMPs?
Would notify them.
You would notify them?
Yeah.
Wickham's arrest in 2021 highlights a key issue here. What happens when the RCMP is called in to enforce the injunction?
That site we're talking about there was where the company was starting to prep work for their drill pad site. In fact, that they were breaching the injunction and breaking the law.
When we're occupying our territory, when we're enforcing Wet'suwet'en law in our territory, that restricts their free access to our resources.
But what else might have motivated the RCMP to move in on the Wet'suwet'en camp when they did? A letter addressed to the then head of CIRG, John Brewer, obtained through an access to information request, shows the company calling on the RCMP to act. A CGL official writes, blockaders are interfering with legally approved work. If nothing is done, CGL says it would ask the courts to step in. The letter was dated November 2nd, 2021. The RCMP raid would take place just over 2 weeks later.
They crossed the line by writing directly to the RCMP. They feel entitled to call the National Police Force directly and to insist that they enforce the injunction.
One of the accusations against CIRG and the allegations is that it's essentially an arm of private industry. What do you say to that?
Yeah, that's absolutely not true. Remember, there's an injunction in place granted by the Supreme Court of British Columbia.
Some of the most serious allegations against CIRG come from its enforcement in Fairy Creek.
It seemed that many of their tactics turned on making the experience as unpleasant as possible for as many people as possible.
Lawyer Karen Mirsky represents dozens of protesters charged in Ferry Creek. She alleges CIRG routinely trampled protesters' charter rights.
The police are effectively using force to push people, separate people from their personal belongings, collecting them en masse, and removing them.
I remember being on the excavator, being with family, being hosed off by the industry workers, and just knowing in every cell in my body that we were standing up for something so much bigger than us.
Angela Davidson is known as Rainbow Eyes. She came to Ferry Creek from the nearby Danakdawa Wilala First Nation. She says she was arrested 5 times.
So when they touched people, all of us saw it. There was high level of violence towards the peaceful protesters.
Don't pick her up like that. Hey, that's not gentle.
We had at least 15 officers on each of us, if not more, to the point where they grabbed us and they slammed us down.
We've talked to a number of protesters who allege that police are using pain compliance techniques in arrests. Is that part of the standard policy?
In some cases, yes. If people are grabbing onto something, we don't strike them. We will use a pain technique to get them to release. It doesn't hurt them.
Raven also alleges CIRG officers conducted cavity searches on her.
They'd pull the pants all the way down, rip up the shirt, and they made sure like they were definitely extensively checking certain areas.
It's one of their stated tactics of the protesters is to make as many complaints, public complaints.
So you're saying these women who allege these kinds of cavity searches, this is a tactic on their part?
Yeah, I am. This has never happened.
Rose Henry says she's heard from alleged victims who say they had been strip searched.
It pisses me off. I just want to get sick. This type of brutality is unacceptable.
Make the allegation that male police officers are strip searching Indigenous females is patently ridiculous. Under my command, that would never happen.
There have been allegations of excessive use of force, so kicking, pushing, choking, punching, kneeling on protesters. What do you say when you hear that list of things?
So again, as I've said before, no arrest looks pretty. It's a violent act. We try to de-escalate as much as possible.
They take our rights because we're violent.
CIRG is facing 265 complaints in Ferry Creek alone.
How does it make you feel when you hear about these stories?
Very concerned. The practice and the impunity behind it, in my mind, is not just troubling, it's shocking.
Mirsky says the Ferry Creek arrest numbers tell a story. More than 1,100 arrested in 2021, but only about 400 made it to court.
We can see that the police were using their discretion the majority of the time in situations where they weren't actually sending people into the court system.
That's a large number of people arrested that don't make it to court.
I mean, correct.
What does that say about the actions on the ground?
So I would say the system's working. We make the determination how serious the breach is. The goal here is to allow industry under the injunction to complete their work, but also allow people to protest.
Police have a lot of discretion in terms of how they enforce injunctions. For example, you can have an incredibly violent policing of injunctions like you saw at Ferry Creek and in Wet'suwet'en territory, or you can see a more hands-off approach as we saw across the country with the Shut Down Canada protests.
Mirsky says she believes CIRG's behavior was meant to send a message.
It says to me that they believed that they were acting to ensure that this movement was crushed.
But it's not just Indigenous groups and activists calling out the RCMP. Coming up.
No, this is not, I'm not going further back than this.
Move back.
You guys can arrest
move
me
back.
If you want.
A BC court judge and one of the RCMP's own officers raised serious concerns about Kerg's behavior.
Kerg is not for everybody, right? And so you get involved in these, some members just can't do it.
And why one Indigenous leader says Kerg is necessary.
Who's supposed to step in to keep the people safe? Who are we to call on to keep our people safe, like all workers?
The main opposition to the pipeline for us is because of our water. It's all filtered glacier water, pure water. Comes from the mountains and the glacier. We welcome you here. This is Kasia territorial lands. Everything that depends on this water is what we depend on. That's what we're all about. That's what we're protecting out here. That's why we're on here.
In August, Wet'suwet'en leaders invited activists and non-governmental organizations on a tour to see firsthand the importance of the Morris River, Wet'suwet'en.
The headwaters of the Wet'suwet'en, one of the most important salmon-bearing rivers in the Wet'suwet'en territories.
Wow.
It connects all of our peoples. Yeah, we'll drink it, but when we get to the Coastal GasLink work site, you know, I'd exercise a bit more caution.
This past spring, further down the river, it looked much different. The spring thaw sent runoff from construction into the river. Despite CGL's assurances it's committed to high environmental protection standards, the company did not control erosion and sediment spills.
It was devastating. It was heartbreaking. There were literally no oxygen in that river at all.
As of September this year, BC's Environmental Office has fined CGL more than $800,000, issued 59 warnings, and stopped work at the site 13 times. In a statement to the Fifth Estate, CGL said, "We continue to work closely with our regulators to improve and adapt our environmental protection measures."
The justification for Kerg has been that these critical infrastructure projects are part of the national interest. Why is it in the national interest to continue to spend money and support these projects?
But not all Indigenous groups oppose the pipeline.
Seeing the environmental protocols that have been taking for the protection of the land, the animals, has been amazing.
On its website and in corporate videos, TC Energy, one of the companies that owns the CGL pipeline, boasts that it signed agreements with 20 First Nations along the pipeline route.
Impact benefit agreements were negotiated with band council chiefs, but the Wet'suwet'en hereditary leadership did not consent to the pipeline.
I'm the former chief of the Wet'suwet'en First Nation. During my tenure as the chief, we consulted a majority of our members within our community and pretty much got their consent for the Coastal GasLink pipeline.
Most communities will share a 10% stake in the pipeline once completed. CGL also says it's handed out almost $2 billion in contracts to Indigenous and local communities.
We had to do what we needed to do for our community. We have poor housing conditions, poor social and economic issues that elected leaders deal with every single day. Our level of employment has increased. The procurement opportunities for our nation has increased, which has brought revenue back to the nation. So I think that it's been a positive outcome for us, despite the controversy.
Chief Wass disagrees.
There's no economic opportunities for Wet'suwet'en. Most of the work that they do is sitting in the trucks, watching this whole thing being built right in front of them. So that's the opportunities that they're talking about.
The debate has caused a rift here between elected band chiefs who govern reserve lands and hereditary chiefs who have jurisdiction over ancestral lands.
The divisions within our houses is literally brothers against brothers, cousins against cousins, relatives against relatives.
Ogun says CIRG is necessary.
Who's supposed to step in to keep the people safe? Who are we to call on to keep our people safe, like all workers?
The conflict with CIRG has gained international attention, from the United Nations to human rights groups like Amnesty International.
As someone who is new to Canada, it's alarming to have that kind of constant policing and a militarization process happening on Indigenous land.
Malak Gebrselassie is preparing a report on human rights issues in Wet'suwet'en territory.
But this one is like really a shock in many ways for us to see a separate branch of a police force actually engaging with Indigenous communities in such a way. It's just unacceptable to see this level of violence.
That violence led one CIRG member to speak out. Obtained through access to information, the Fifth Estate has details why a 13-year veteran of the RCMP walked away from CIRG. While stationed in Ferry Creek, he says officers described smashing windows of abandoned cars, confiscating protesters' personal property, and how he was told to drive those they arrested to a town an hour and a half away just to make it harder for them to return. Holding someone in custody to make things more inconvenient and driving them down the highway when they are to be released without charges is not justifiable. The officer says against directions, CIRG officers would chat and joke with industry workers and security about the fucking hippies. He said they were ordered to remove their name tags and given thin blue line patches instead. We were told blue line patches piss off the hippies, so wear them.
What do you say when one of your own officers is expressing concerns about the behavior of CIRG?
So we specifically investigated this. We met with that officer, show us the evidence, talk to us, give a statement, and nothing was forthcoming. You got people screaming at you, people throwing things at you, people resisting you. You're outnumbered 90% of the time. That's not something that every person can do, let alone every police officer.
The officer signed off his letter saying, I saw enough to know that I did not want to be involved, and actions were certainly a departure from what we practice at our home detachments.
We can appreciate why somebody would be reluctant to speak out against their colleagues. I mean, it hasn't always been popular within the RCMP to be a whistleblower.
Well,
I mean,
he wasn't reluctant, though, was he? He put it in paper, right? He was, and so we said, okay, you've made these allegations. Come forward with specific evidence. You're a police officer. Nothing.
Ignited a fire just behind the tarps at the west end of the bridge.
My police officers have been assaulted. They've been attacked. Our vehicles have been burnt, right, targeted by arson.
Brewer says policing here is dangerous. There was this attack on CGL in February 2022. A masked group of 20 people threatened workers using flares and axes. The company says it caused millions of dollars in damage. To date, no arrests have been made. Brewer also says at Ferry Creek, protesters deliberately tried to make arrests difficult, like using sleeping dragons, chaining themselves to buried concrete or metal pipes.
We have people that have, bike collars around their necks, suspended 30 feet in the air on a rickety tripod. They've got themselves in sleeping dragons dug into the road, and we have to extract them. We have to make those arrests in very difficult situations. At every time, the emphasis is on safety.
We don't want to start whooshing pepper spray around.
No.
Remember, that show of force gets to that level only after all the attempts to solve this peacefully have been made. Days, weeks, sometimes months.
But a BC judge also had harsh words for CIRG. In Ferry Creek, he said the RCMP's interference with the liberties of the media and public was substantial and serious.
I've been here for 4 weeks covering. I've never been pushed back this far before.
Pushing the media back and arbitrarily setting up so-called exclusion zones.
We're done. Doesn't matter. Want to be arrested? Feel your boots. It doesn't bother me.
We called it the Wild Wild West for those of us out there because it was their game. They changed the rules. They changed the exclusion line. They had uniforms on, but they were just a bunch of thugs.
Grab his legs. Grab his legs. Okay, we're going to pull him this way.
Coming up, how much does it cost to keep CIRG running?
You're paying these people to continue this legacy that has gone on since the beginning of colonization.
And what should happen to CIRG?
We're not just saying they should be nicer when they come and remove us from our territories. They shouldn't be removing us from our territories.
We can send probably two guys over pretty quick.
Yeah,
and then
okay.
Just hold the perimeter on that side.
Okay. And then we'll follow a factor. Okay.
Back off! You back the fuck off!
Back the fuck off! Fucking pig!
This police body camera footage shows what CIRG officers face on the front lines.
You're under arrest. Both of you are under arrest.
Fuck you!
No! I'm coming down! No!
You're not!
This video hasn't been widely seen.
Careful.
Back off.
Released as part of a court case, it shows the intensity of CIRG operations.
Get these under control right now. Everybody else stay back.
The first gate has been breached. There has been some arrests.
But also the unit's resources. In 2019-2020, CIRG operations cost close to $10 million in Wet'suwet'en.
Drone from Air One. We have that subject back up in the tree trying to cut it down. We can't get good ID from up here.
Drone copies, we'll try and get ID of the man trying to cut the tree.
In Ferry Creek in 2021-2022, CIRG spending exploded. $18 million for equipment, staff, transportation, and communications. In total, since 2017, the RCMP has spent almost $50 million on CIRG operations.
Is that an effective use of taxpayer dollars?
I guess I'll ask you, these are multi-billion dollar projects that are being stopped.
The priority is always profit over people, especially Indigenous people, especially people of color.
I think they should leave. It should be disbanded. And they're not welcome in this land ever.
You're paying these people to continue this legacy that has gone on since the beginning of colonization. CIRG needs to be dismantled. We need to save the land.
These are practices that we need to be very, very careful about, because if they are used here against one group, where are they going to be used again?
And I think it's time that we put a call out to all people. We got to step up to the plate.
In Ferry Creek, the resistance continues, though the front lines are more calm now. Many are waiting to see if their complaints against CIRG will result in any charges or discipline against CIRG officers. But the process is slow. Of the 560 complaints, most did not fit the oversight criteria, so were rejected outright. So far, the RCMP has dismissed more than 85% of the allegations from Ferry Creek, and no officer has faced a disciplinary hearing.
There's allegations of psychological warfare, is the word that protesters used. You know, at what point does that go from normal policing to harassment, intimidation?
That's called proactive policing. It's our job as police officers to enforce the law. We don't pick the law. We don't make the law.
Do you have any regrets about how things have been handled in the last few years?
No, I don't.
CGL declined our request for an on-camera interview. In a statement to the Fifth Estate, the company said, "Security is necessary to protect the safety of our workforce and the community and to control access to our work sites for safety purposes." With lawsuits before the courts, the company wouldn't comment further. CIRG is facing a systemic review by the RCMP's oversight body. It will examine policies, training, and tactics. And while there will be a public report, The RCMP isn't legally required to follow the recommendations.
I don't think that they have any real teeth to do anything. I think that there needs to be political will to actually make some drastic changes. We're not just saying they should be nicer when they come and remove us from our territories. They shouldn't be removing us from our territories. They shouldn't exist here on Wet'suwet'en territory.
In Wet'suwet'en, the pipeline is now fully installed. In Fairy Creek, logging in key areas is on hold until 2025, and CIRG doesn't appear to be going anywhere. While the review takes place, their teams are still deployed. And this spring, the province announced stable funding for CIRG for the next 3 years.
This mural here was done by our youth. You'll see in the middle of the face and a hand, and you'll see the RCMP symbol.
In Wet'suwet'en territory, Frida Hewson says the fight against CIRG will be remembered.
So this is going to be a historical story that will be told for years down the road. Even after I'm gone, they'll talk about this.
On the Morris River, they continue to take stock of the water, the land, and the fight ahead.
We're fighting for our kids. Not for me, not for my daughters, but our grandkids and the little ones that's not born yet. That's what is at stake.
Indigenous communities here say no matter what happens to CIRG, bigger questions about land rights remain, and the answers won't come from a special police force.
I always tell people, these need to be resolved by governments, not the police. We are not resolving, 150 years of conflict staring down the barrel of a gun.